Chapter 6 The Painted Hall. In 1707, James Thornhill began painting what was planned as the hospital dining room. He didn't finish for another 18 years, at which point the hall became an instant tourist attraction. But in 1805, following another threat of invasion, visitors came for a very different reason.
We know not whether we should mourn or rejoice. The country has gained the most splendid victory ever to grace England's naval annals. But it has been dearly purchased. Nelson is no more. The Admiral fell in the moment of victory over the fleets of France and Spain off Cape Trafalgar. His honoured remains will return aboard his flagship.
A yacht went down the Thames for the purpose of meeting HMS Victory. The ship hove in sight and the coffin, covered with an ensign, was received on deck. The yacht then immediately proceeded for Greenwich. In the evening, the body was brought ashore with the greatest privacy, and with the requisite arrangements made for its lying in state, it was deposited in the Painted Hall. The Reverend Mr. Scott, chaplain of the Victory, who Nelson requested in his last moments to pay particular attention to his remains, stayed with the body the whole of the night, accompanied by the undertaker. The hall was fitted up for this melancholy spectacle with peculiar taste and elegance. The windows and floor were shrouded with black cloth, double rows of candles imparting light. A large black curtain was suspended at the entrance to the upper hall. Inside was the funeral saloon. Over the coffin, a canopy of black was festooned with gold, and above it, a golden wreath inscribed with the word Trafalgar. The coffin was covered with a black sable pall, lined with white satin, and turned up at the foot so as to expose the lower part. At the head sat the Reverend Scott as chief mourner, dressed in his cassock and without powder. 10 mourners attended, dressed in deep mourning, with black scarves, full powdered, and wearing bag wigs. On Saturday, the Princess of Wales entered the saloon, where she remained for a considerable time, contemplating with silent sorrow. The following day, the hall was opened for the admission of strangers. This solemn exhibition continued for 3 days. 30,000 persons paid their final tributes. On the last day, the sable pall was cast from the coffin, the most elegant ever seen in Europe. The headpiece was a portrait of the deceased hero, over which reclined the figure of grief. At the base was the British lion, his paw laid on the Gallic cockerel. Sphinxes commemorated victory obtained on the shores of Egypt, and other trophies indicated that he might fairly claim sovereignty of the ocean. A cushion supported the coronet, the reward of his lordship's services to king and country. The 10 mourners stood 5 on each side, facing inwards. The effect was rendered solemn and impressive. The body was to be carried in procession by water to London for the funeral. A little before 4 o'clock, a brig hauled alongside the quay, having on board the crew of the Victory. The brave tars came ashore amidst grateful acclamations. A signal was given, and an avenue of guards armed with swords and pikes formed across the grass plat between the hall and the river. The coffin was carried from the saloon by 12 bearers in full mourning, past 500 of the Greenwich pensioners, the guard presenting arms, the great bell over the southeast colonnade tolling a funeral knell. The coffin was taken on the royal barge, draped in black velvet and black ostrich feathers, the St. George's Jack lowered half-mast high. Oars were taken up by 10 heroes of Trafalgar. The shores were lined with thousands of spectators. Every hat was off, and every countenance expressed the deepest regret for the loss of a character which cannot, I fear, appear again in our time.
The next chapter is about Prince Frederick's barge in the National Maritime Museum.